From Babylon to Timbuktu, a history of the ancient black races, including the black Hebrews, by Rudolph R. Windsor. Chapter 1, Ancient Black Civilization. More than 6,000 years ago, in the land called Mesopotamia, there developed the most remarkable civilization then known to mankind. This civilization was centered between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. These rivers begin in the mountains of Armenia and flow in a southeastern direction towards the Persian Gulf. The soil of this area is tremendously fertile because of the alluvial deposits brought down by the two rivers. European civilization developed from ancient black civilization. Without this black civilization, white domination and influence as we know it today would have been improbable. A number of different tribes were entrenched in the southern part of the Tigris-Euphrates River region. This southern section was known at different times by many names, among which are Sumer, Akkad, and Chaldea. But the name best known to us is Babylonia. This area was also the location of the Garden of Eden, and the people of this region were jet black. I shall prove conclusively that the black people have the most ancient history of all humans. The best available source of proof is the history of the Jews, known as the Bible. In Genesis chapter 2 verse 10 it is written, "And a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from thence it was parted and became into four heads. There were four rivers which watered the Garden of Eden. I shall cite the third and the fourth rivers first, then I shall proceed to the first and the second rivers, because it fits better into my line of reasoning." Genesis chapter 2 verse 14 reads, "And the name of the third river is Hiddekel, that is it which goeth towards the east of Assyria. And the fourth river is Euphrates." Commentators and scholars have identified the river Hiddekel. They say it is the Tigris River. Now I shall cite Genesis chapter 2 verse 13, "And the name of the second river is Gihon, the same is it that compasseth the whole land of Ethiopia." Because the Garden of Eden is associated with the land of Ethiopia, we can conclude that the people were black. Rashi, the 11th century commentator on the Bible, said that the Gihon is the Nile River that bows through eastern Africa. Rashi most likely makes this point because the Nile flows in Ethiopia and into Egypt. Dr. Spicer, who was a professor at the University of Pennsylvania, said, "There is no basis for the detouring of the Gihon to Ethiopia." He meant the Ethiopian Africa, not to mention the Paishan in various remote regions of the world. I agree with Dr. Spicer that we should not search for the Gihon in Africa, nor the Paishan in a remote area of the earth, but that we should search for the Paishan and the Gihon in the Tigris-Euphrates Valley. There were two Ethiopian nations in ancient times, Eastern Ethiopia and Western Ethiopia. This point, Dr. Spicer failed to elucidate, possibly because of an oversight. There was an Ethiopian civilization in southern Mesopotamia, Babylon, but the people in this region did not use their tribal name, Ethiopia, to designate their nationality. They called themselves by the name of the cities that they constructed and inhabited, or they called themselves by the event that happened there. For example, God confused the language of the people at the Tower of Babel. Babel means confusion in Hebrew. This is why the Ethiopian tribes called themselves Babylonians, referring to the name of the city that they constructed. There are many nations that are not designated by their true nationality. For example, the white Australians came from England, but those Englishmen who live in Australia do not call themselves by their ancestral name. They call themselves by the name of the country which they colonized, which is Australia. The people of Australia are represented in the United Nations by the name of their nation, Australia, and not under their ancestral name, England. The people who resided in the lower part of the Tigris-Euphrates Valley were Ethiopian, black in complexion. We read in Genesis chapter 10 verse 8 that Cush begot Nimrod. The word Cush means Ethiopian, and Cush was the father of the Ethiopians. For the meaning of the word Kush, see Webster's New Collegiate Dictionary. Nimrod was a mighty Ethiopian conqueror and builder in the land of Shinar. We find in Genesis chapter 10, verses 8 through 10, that Nimrod ruled over such cities as Babylon, Erech, Akkad. All these cities are situated in the land of Shinar. Another name for Shinar is Sumer. This civilization was a high order and one of the oldest civilizations in ancient times. In Genesis chapter 10, verse 7, we read, "And the sons of Cush, Seba, and Havilah." Now we have learned that Havilah was the son of Cush, who was an Ethiopian. The word Havilah became the name of a tribe and a region known as the Land of Havilah, and the Havilites, Ethiopians, lived in the Land of Havilah. Moreover, scholars have located this land near the Persian Gulf. In search of the Land of Havilah, we find that there was another Havilah, who one of the sons of Joktan. Read Genesis chapter 10, verse 26 to 29. But this Havilah was the line of Shem. Read Genesis chapter 10, verse 22. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The children of Shem are called Shemites. The sons of Ham are called Hamites, and the sons of Japheth are called Japhites. We should not confuse Havilah, the son of Joktan, with Havilah, the son of Cush. Now it is logical to conclude that Havilah, the son of Cush, is intended in Genesis chapter 2, verse 11, to be the Havilah of the land of Havilah, because that Havilah was a Cushite, Ethiopian. His habitation would naturally be adjacent to his brother, Nimrod, who ruled Babylon. Abraham was one of the fathers of the 12 tribes of Israel, and Abraham's father, Terah, came from the land of Ur, or the Chaldees, Genesis chapter 11, verse 26 to 28. The land of Ur of the Chaldees was located at the southern part of the Euphrates. The Chaldeans were one of many Cushite tribes. Cush means black, according to the Bible dictionary. This dictionary defines further Cush, the name of a son of Ham, apparently the eldest, and of territories occupied by his descendants. The Cushites appear to have spread along tracks extending from the Higher Nile to the Euphrates and the Tigris rivers. History affords many connections between Babylon, Arabia, and Ethiopia. There is more than adequate evidence that the ancient nations of Babylon, Akkadia, Sumer, and Chaldea were inhabited by Cushite tribes, Ethiopians, on all sides of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. Pishon and the Gihon rivers, mentioned in Genesis chapter 2, verses 11 to 13, wind and turned through the land of Havilah, somewhere near the Persian Gulf. Although it is difficult to identify these two rivers exactly, most likely the center of the Garden of Eden was in the lower part of the Tigris-Euphrates Valley. This was the most fertile region in the Middle East, with its many canals and lakes. No wonder it is called the Garden of Eden. It was so well watered that the vegetation looked better than an English park. The Tigris and Euphrates River joined before they reached the Persian Gulf. Then they separate again, making the four rivers of the channels of these two rivers. This is one of the theories of the top-rated authorities. The modern names of the rivers that flow into the Tigris and Euphrates are the Great Zab, south of Nineveh, the Little Zab, south of the Great Zab, the Diyala. The river flows into the Tigris at Baghdad, Iraq. Sumer and Kish. Before the dispersal of mankind at the Tower of Babel, this region was not called Babylon. It was only after the confusion of the language and the dispersal of the people that the name Babel was given to the tower. This conclusion is reached by way of logic. What was the name of this region and tower before the confusion of the language and the dispersal? Webster's Dictionary, Gazetteer section, says Sumer is the southern division of ancient Babylon. Moreover, this same dictionary says on page 849, Sumerian, the pre-Shemitic population of the lower Euphrates Valley. The pre-Shemitic population means that the black Sumerians were there first. This point is in harmony with my original position that the people in lower Mesopotamia were Eastern Ethiopians. These Sumerians or Ethiopians and their kindred appear to have settled along tracks from Mesopotamia to India. This area now includes southern Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and northwest India. The first and second allusions to Sumer in the Bible are in Genesis chapter 10, verse 10, and chapter 11, verse 1. Under the name Shinar, Webster's Dictionary, Gazetteer section, hints to this relationship of Shinar and Sumer. There is definitely a blood relationship between the Dravidian tribes of India and the Ethiopian Sumerians. The Sumerian civilization preceded the Babylonian. The Sumerians founded cities that existed more than 4,000 years BC, such as Eridu, Lagash, Nippur, Kish, and Ur. Archaeologists have found skeletons of ancient Dravidian and Neda types in Ur and Kish. Antiquated Sumerian statues resemble the statues of the Dravidian civilization. Chapter 2, The Origin of the White Race. After the destruction of mankind by the flood, Noah and his wife, his three sons and their wives were the only people that were saved. The sons of Noah were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. From these three sons of Noah was the whole earth populated. The ark rested on Mount Ararat. Mount Ararat was located in the land of Armenia. The word Armenia and Ararat mean high ground. The entire earth at this time was of one speech and one language. Most of the people dwelled in the plain of Shinar, in Hebrew, the Valley of Shinar. Men began to congregate in the territory and to build a tower up to heaven. The Jewish historian Flavius Josephus says God also commanded them to send colonies abroad for the thorough peopling of the earth, but the people did not obey God. Now when man was in the process of building the tower, God disapproved of its construction because it showed a disbelief in his word. The divine had promised Noah that he would not destroy the earth by water again. Nimrod the Ethiopian was the leader of the conspiracy against God. He was a mighty man and a conqueror. He held the people under his dictatorship. When God considered what had been done, he confused men's language and scattered them towards the four directions of the earth. The sons of Noah were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Because the world was populated from these three sons of Noah, it is proper to classify men only according to this classification, Shemites, Hamites, and Japhites, and not Caucasoid, Mongoloid, or Negroid. The latter category is a modern anthropological classification that we will deal with more thoroughly later. The parts of the earth inhabited by the children of Shem were parts of the territory of Assyria and Elam, Persia, east of the Tigris River, the eastern part of Syria, and parts of the Arabian Peninsula. All the children of Shem were black. This position will be supported by arguments and facts later. The second classification of mankind was the Hamites, who controlled the great centers of civilization in ancient time, 4000 BC, soon after the flood. This civilization included the continent of Africa, the land of Canaan, Israel, parts of Arabia, Syria, Phoenicia, Turkey, Babylonia, southern Persia, Iran, East Pakistan, and a large part of India. The third classification of mankind was the Japhites from Japheth, who was the youngest son of Noah. The offspring of Japheth occupied the isles of the Gentiles, the shore territories of the Mediterranean Sea in Europe and parts of Asia Minor. Whence they dispersed northward over the entire continent of Europe and a great part of Asia. After Noah's ark rested on the mountain of Ararat and the dispersal of the children of men at the Tower of Babel, Japheth's descendants traveled west, north, and northeast of the mountain of Ararat and the Caucasus Mountains. The Japhites settled near the mountains Taurus and Amus in Turkey. They journeyed to the river Tanais in southern Russia along Europe to Cadiz, Spain. The sons of Japheth were Gomer, Magog, Javan, Tubal, Meshech, and Tiras. Genesis chapter 10 verses 2. Gomer was the ancestor of the first Sumerians and of the later Cimbri, including other offshoots of the Celtic family, and of the present-day Gaels of Ireland, Scotland, and the Hebrides islands. These Sumerians were described by Homer the Greek as dwelling in a remote place of mist and gloom. This place was located north of the Black Sea. The second son of Japheth was Magog, father of the Magogites. Flavius Josephus said that the Greeks called these people Scythians. The Scythians included all the wandering tribes who dwelt mostly near the north of the Black and Caspian Seas. They were regarded by ancients as tremendously lacking in intelligence and civilization. The third son of Japheth was Madai, the father of the Medes. They were located at the southern part of the Caspian Sea, and they later united with the Persians to form one race. From Javan, the fourth son of Japheth, came Ionians and all the Greeks. Tubal, the fifth son of Japheth, is associated with Javan, Isaiah 66, verse 19. Meshech and Tubal, Ezekiel chapter 32, verse 26 and 39, verse 1, are nations of the north, north of the focal point of the land of Israel. Josephus identified the descendants of Tubal with the early Iberians, Iberes. They were the inhabitants of the territory between the Caspian and Euxine Seas, which is Georgia in southern Russia. The last son of Japheth was Tiras, the father or ancestor of the Thracians. This land, Thrace, was situated north of Turkey, Asia Minor, and the northeast of Greece. Japheth's grandson, Ashkenaz, formed the Germanic race. In the Hebrew language, the word means German. By 378 AD, the Germanic tribes were on the move. They were known under these names: Lombards, Burgundians, Franks, Saxons, Angles, Jutes, Ostrogoths, Visigoths, Suevis, and Vandals. These 10 Germanic barbarian tribes settled all over Western Europe and intermingled with modern nations of Western Europe as we know them today. All these tribes were the descendants of Japheth. The ancient people did not classify races according to skin color, like the modern nations of Europe and America. The ancients, including the Greeks and Romans, identified people according to their national or tribal names. They used such names as Visigoths, Vandals, Saxons, Ethiopians, Carthaginians, Jews, Arabs, Persians, Babylonians, Egyptians, and Moors. They did not use the term Negro, which is a modern term, to refer to black races, or the word Caucasian to refer to white races. Dividing the world along a color line was an idea that originated with the white supremacists in Europe after the Renaissance. The Europeans did not have any great civilization immediately after the fall of Greece and Rome. During the Middle Ages, the black nations of Africa and Asia had the greatest political, economical, educational, and military influence in the world. At this time, Europe existed in a state of darkness for 1,000 years. In the 17th century and later, Europe began to emerge out of the slot of ignorance, and certain Germans and others conceived of themselves as belonging to a superior race. Johann F. Blumenbach, a German, was the first to divide humanity on the basis of skin color. Up to this time, no such attempts had been made. His classification set up a color line to the detriment of later generations. Mr. Blumenbach classified 5 chief races of mankind: the Caucasian, Mongolian, Ethiopian, American Indian, the Malayan. Moreover, he considered the Caucasian to be the original race. Blumenbach, the anthropologist, named the whites after the Caucasus Mountains. These mountains are situated between the Black and Caspian Seas because he thought the purest white people originated there. Blumenbach was a racist, and so was J. A. Gobineau. A third man by the name of H. S. Chamberlain wanted to advance the supremacy of the white Nordic race and its culture. These men attributed psychological value and importance to race. This was racism, and it led to the horrible, vicious racial philosophy and to the persecution of the Jews in Nazi Germany. T.R. Garth wrote in his book Race Psychology, 1931, "Any disposition on our part to withhold from some race the right to a free and full development must be taken as an indication of rationalization on the account of race prejudice, and such an attitude is inexcusable in an intelligent populace. As I have proven, the earliest civilizations began in North Africa and the Middle East among black races. Read about the Black Asiatics in Herbert Wentz's It Began in Babel, a book on the origin of races. We have more than adequate proof that the white races began near the Caucasus Mountains, and from there they spread north, northwest, and northeast into Europe and Asiatic Russia. Now we know that the Japhites, Europeans, are white today. Were they originally white beginning from their ancestor Japheth, or did a change materialize in the skin of the descendants of Japheth? This question is difficult to answer. I was told that Japheth was a black man, but he wanted to be white, so God changed him to a white man. Evidence to that theory is lacking. Nevertheless, scientists and anthropologists have found different kinds of mutations in certain parts of the world. A physical mutation is a sudden variation or change, the offspring differing from its parent in some outstanding characteristic. Also, a major change in the chromosomes or genes that determine heredity. Blonde hair among the Black Australian Aborigines is an example of a mutation, and probably albinos are a good example of mutations with their white skin, woolly hair, thick lips, and Ethiopian noses. Any sudden change from the normal is to be regarded as a mutation. Other examples of mutation are blondism and whiteness among monkeys, apes, and chimpanzees. Major mutations or changes took place among the descendants of Japheth. This is obvious because of their white skin. In other words, they were black at one time, but their skin changed to white. This phenomenon can be understood in the view of the total world population. Over two-thirds of the population of the world consists of colored people. That is a ratio of 2 to 1. Two out of Noah's three sons remained black. We know this to be true because many of the people throughout Africa, Asia, Latin America, and the islands in the Pacific Ocean are yellow, brown, or black. They have facial features like the Congoid Africans, especially the Vietnamese, Filipinos, the people of India. They are a mixture of Black Dravidians and Indo-Europeans, Thailanders, Burmese, Indonesians, Guanyans, Sumatrans, and Aborigines of Australia, etc. You can get a good idea of the features of these people by reading the geographical magazines and observing the foreign students who come from these countries. There was an Indo-European invasion, Germanic, of the Middle East between the years 2000 and 1500 BC. These Germanic tribes intermingled with the black people everywhere they traveled. This mingling made the people in Syria, Babylon, Assyria, Persia, India, and parts of Arabia much lighter in complexion. Now, the color of the people in this region ranges from brown to yellow. The Greek and Roman invasions also made these people in the Middle East lighter. Another fact we should not forget is that the Moors and Arabs from North Africa captured and raped European women. As a result, the North Africans became lighter. At one time, these people in North Africa and Middle East were all black. White have intermingled their blood with blacks in Asia, Africa, and the Western Hemisphere. In spite of this, the colored people of the world control about 3/4 of the Earth's geographical area. Because the colored people of the world are in a majority, it is proper to infer that the whites have always been a minority, and that the black people are the original people of humanity. It is interesting and meaningful to learn that the Japhites, Europeans, traveled northwest, north, and northeast of the mountainous region of the Caucasus into Europe. It gives me the impression that the Japhites were isolated, or that they isolated themselves from the civilization and domination of Nimrod, which began in the land of Mesopotamia. When the Japhites separated at the Tower of Babel, the theory and probability is that they turned white. There are many cases of individuals turning white in Jewish biblical history. When God wanted to show Moses a miracle, he turned his hand white as snow, then he turned it back again to its original color, black. In ancient Israel, when a man had a white spot in his skin, or white or yellow hair, or white skin somewhat reddish, he was pronounced unclean. All people who were victims of this shameful disease were isolated outside of the camp or city. Those that had leprosy were called lepers, and they had to shout, "Unclean, unclean." All people in the ancient world who had yellow hair and leprosy were despised and segregated. This is one reason the white supremacists discriminate against the black people today. Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses and defamed his character because he married an Ethiopian woman. As a punishment, God struck Miriam with leprosy and she turned white as snow. Now many people have deceived themselves in thinking that Miriam and Aaron spoke against her because she was a black woman. But this is not the case, because Miriam, Aaron, and Moses were all black people. They spoke against Moses because the Ethiopian woman was of a different religion. The color issue did not exist in their day. To prove this point, the Israelites dwell among the Hamites, Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. They intermarried. All the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served Balaam, the idol god. Because they served the idol, Balaam, the god of Israel, became angry and sold them into slavery. It was the worshiping of the idols, not the marriages, that God disapproved. Marriages were forbidden because God feared that the alien races would persuade the Israelites to worship their idols. But in Moses' case, he had converted the Ethiopian woman to his religion. Mary and Aaron used the Ethiopian woman as an excuse to challenge the authority of Moses. It was a family dispute of jealousy among the three of them. Moreover, Miriam and Aaron were older than Moses. They said, "Hath the Lord indeed spoken only by Moses? Hath he not also spoken by us?" And the Lord heard it. In another case of leprosy, God showed Moses some miracles to display to the children of Israel that they would believe that Moses was sent by God. In this case, Moses' hand turned white. Naaman and Gehazi had leprosy. I will write a summary of this story. Naaman was the captain of the Syrian army. He acquired leprosy, boils, and whitening of the skin. He wanted to be cured. Then he heard about Elisha, the prophet. Elisha told him to dip 7 times in the Jordan River. Naaman obeyed and he was cursed. A reward was offered and he was cured. Naaman obeyed and he was cured. A reward was offered Elijah, but he refused it. A servant of Elisha named Gehazi wanted the reward that his master Elisha refused. Then Gehazi ran to look for Naaman. When he found him, he asked him for the reward and said that his master had sent him. This, of course, was a lie. When Gehazi returned to Elijah, Elijah said, "I know you have gotten garments, olive yards, and all kinds of wealth by names of subterfuge. Therefore, the leprosy that Naaman had will cleave to you and to your seed descendants forever." And he departed from his presence a leper as white as snow. This type of leprosy affected the reproductive organs, genes, and chromosomes that determine hereditary characteristics in his body. This meant all his children would produce white offspring, even though he was a black man at first. This was the curse of Gehazi. Chapter 3. Afro-Asian Culture Goes to Europe. The Sumerians, Babylonians, and Ethiopians were black people. They contributed much to the advancement of civilization. Because they studied astrology, they were capable of formulating many principles of astronomy. These black people were so sagacious and skillful that they were able to divide the years into months, weeks, hours, minutes, and seconds. In mathematics, they developed the decimal system. The most famous of the Babylonian kings was Hammurabi, who ruled about 2150 BC. He was outstanding for his codification of a system of laws founded on retaliation as the punitive measure for crime. He also established a 7-day week, with the last day a rest day or Sabbath. This idea was adopted by the Hebrews and then transmitted to the Greeks, Romans, and other Europeans. The literature of the Babylonians is quite interesting. Long ago, these black people wrote with a sharp instrument on clay tablets. Thousands of these tablets have been found, and some of them disclose a popular work known as the Enuma Elish, or the creation epic. The story of how the world began derived from the Babylonians. After the dispersal of mankind at the Tower of Babel, the Black Hamites migrated towards the east, south, southwest, and the west. These Black Hamites settled in the land of Canaan. Later on, it was called Israel. The land of Canaan gets its name from the youngest son of Ham, who was Canaan. The Canaanites were the primordial aborigines of the land of Canaan. We may call them Africans because of their blood relationship to the other inhabitants of the African continent. There were 11 Canaanite tribes living in the land of Canaan and surrounding it before the Black Israelites possessed it. The greatest cultural and commercial cities of these Black Canaanites were Tyre and Sidon, sometimes written Zidon. This city gets its name from Sidon, the firstborn son of Canaan. The Sidonians and the Tyrians were of the same race, and their kings ruled over both of these cities. In many history books, you will read about Sidonians under the name Phoenician. The Greeks called the Sidonians Phoenicians, land of palms, because they found many palm trees there. But the Sidonians called their nation by the name of Canaan, Canaan, Phoenicia, or land of the Sidonians, was located to the north of Palestine along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea, bounded by the sea on the west and by the mountain ranges of Lebanon on the east. Tyre and Sidon were founded about 2300 BC. The Tell El Amarna tablets show that Tyre was a place of great strength in the 15th century BC. Sidon was still older. For a long time, it was the only Black Phoenician city known to the Greeks. Even after Tyre took the leadership, the Greeks and Hebrews spoke of the Phoenicians as Sidonians, and King Ethbal of Tyre is called King of the Sidonians. These Black people were proficient in philosophy, astronomy, geometry, arithmetic, and navigation. They had good harbors, which enabled them to navigate to distant lands such as Cyprus, Sardinia, Crete, Rhodes, Cadiz in Spain, Sicily, Carthage in North Africa near Tunis, Tangier, Ophir, and the Canary Isles. These Phoenicians were skilled also in metalwork, needlework, and embroidery. They extracted dye from shellfish abounding in adjacent waters. This dye became known later as Tyrian purple. They made glass from the white sand of the Mediterranean coast. The Phoenicians spoke a Hamitic-Shemitic language so closely allied to the Hebrew that Phoenician and Hebrew, though different dialects, may practically be regarded as the same language. As it was previously stated, there were 11 Canaanite tribes: Sidonians, Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites, Girgashites, Hivites, Arkites, Sinites, Arvadites, Samarites, and the Hamathites. Hebrew has its origin in the Canaanite language. When Abraham came from the region of Babylon into the land of Canaan, he found the Canaanite language similar to his own language. Abraham communicated very well with the inhabitants of the new land, adopted the Canaanite language, made certain modifications, and it became known as Hebrew. The Hebrew language was very similar to the Canaanite, says the Bible Dictionary. Phoenician and Canaanite, or Canaanite, can be classified as the African language because the Canaanite were blood brothers of the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Nubians, Sudanese, and other Africans. The Phoenicians established a colony in North Africa called Carthage, and they, the Carthaginians, always considered themselves Canaanites. When Moses led the Black Israelites out of Egypt, northeast Africa, Moses died in the wilderness. Then Joshua led the Israelites into the land of Canaan and dispossessed the Canaanites. Now, it is written in a Jewish book called the Babylonian Talmud. For when the Africans came to plead against the Jews before Alexander of Macedon, they said, "Canaan belongs to us, as it is written, the land of Canaan with the coast thereof, and Canaan was the ancestor of these people, ourselves." These Canaanites, or Africans, were driven out of the land of Canaan by Joshua about 332 BC. Alexander conquered Palestine. As stated above, the Africans came to Alexander claiming that the land of Canaan belonged to them. The point that I want to elucidate is that these Canaanites considered themselves African. Consequently, we can correctly say that the Hebrew Canaanite language is one of the African languages. Many of the private houses of these black people were equipped with cisterns for storing water. The wealth of Phoenicia, or Carthage, was predicated on clandestine technical procedures in manufacture, secret mines of advantages and expensive metals, concealed secret trading posts in the remote areas from Ethiopia to Pilars of Hercules. Their knowledge of navigation enabled them to reach the British Isles and the Arctic Ocean. The English alphabet derived from the two ancient black nations, the Phoenician Canaanite alphabet and the Hebrew. The Phoenicians had a powerful navy. They were a great trading people. When the Phoenicians traded with the Greeks did not have an alphabet. As a result, they adopted the Phoenician alphabet in order to transact business. The Greeks passed this alphabet to the Romans, and the Romans transmitted it to the German Anglo-Saxon tribes. Then it was brought to the British Isles. The first two letters of the Phoenician and Hebrew alphabet are Alph and Bet, which is similar to the word alphabet. The Black Phoenicians also gave a system of ways and measures to the Europeans. The city of Carthage was called the Queen of the Sea. The Carthaginians controlled the commerce in the Mediterranean Sea. A new nation emerged in the peninsula of Italy, Rome, which challenged the commercial interest of the supremacy of Carthage in the Mediterranean. This state of hostility led to three long wars called the Punic Wars. The first Punic War was in the years 264 to 241 BC, mostly naval battles, which Italy won. The second Punic War was fought in the years 218 to 201 BC. A black general by the name of Hannibal was the extraordinary figure who did what was considered the impossible by crossing the Alps with elephants. In Italy, he was victorious over the Romans. He was very resourceful and crafty. When he got into a difficult situation at one time, he drove herds of cattle into the Romans. His unexpected victories amazed and terrified the city of Rome. But at the end, because of the lack of men and supplies, he had to return to Africa, Carthage. The Third Punic War was in the years 149 to 146 BC and fought at Zama in Africa. Because of Hannibal's skills in warfare, his strategy is taught in military colleges around the world. The Egyptians. The Egyptians are Africans and descendants of the Hamites. All Hamites are the offspring of their father, Ham. The first Egyptian was called Mizraim, according to the Hebrews. Mizraim was the son of Ham, Genesis chapter 10, verse 6. Ancient and modern scholars have established the location of Mizraim as Egypt. The word Mizraim is a plural form meaning Upper and Lower Egypt. About 3,300 years before the Christian era, Egypt was divided into two kingdoms. A great black pharaoh king named Menes united these two kingdoms by conquest. The later pharaohs wore a dynastic insignia of their crown, the snake of Lower Egypt and the hawk of Upper Egypt, representing the time when Egypt was divided. These subsequent pharaohs held the title of King of Upper and Lower Egypt. After Egypt was united, her navy went out into the Mediterranean and traded with the inhabitants of the coastal towns and islands such as Crete and Cyprus. Thousands of years ago, the Egyptians established powerful governments and built empires that extended in all directions. They even held dominion over the Canaanite brothers in Palestine for a long period of time. These black Egyptians were proficient in mathematics, medicine, engineering, and agriculture. They used geometry to reserve the land every year after the Nile River overflowed. Pythagoras, the Greek mathematician, learned mathematics from the black Egyptians. By the way, algebra came from the black Arabs. The word algebra came from the Arabic word algebra, as it means the science of equations. When the black Moors conquered Spain and Portugal, they carried algebra into Europe. And Mizraim begot Ludim and Anamim and Lehabim and Naphtuhim and Parthusim and Kalsuhim. out of whom came Philistines, and Kaphtorim. When Mizraim begot his children, they dwelled in Egypt, except the Kaphtorim and Philistines, which inhabited the islands of Crete in the Mediterranean Sea. In remote ancient times, the people not only of Asia and Africa were black, but also the people of the southern European lands on the Mediterranean Sea, the black races that controlled the commerce and established colonies on the Mediterranean were the Phoenicians and the Philistines. Herbert Went, in his book It Began in Babel, says that Crete was a dominant power during and up to the 2nd century BC. This certain power could have been no other than part of the Phoenician Carthaginian Empire, because the city of Carthage did not fall until the year 146 BC. Where did European civilization and culture begin? Scholars say that it came from Africa and Asia through Crete. Investigators consider Crete to be the birthplace of European culture. There are many myths surrounding the island of Crete. One is, it was to Crete that Zeus, father of the gods, abducted the Phoenician princess Europa and their fathered three sons upon her. Zeus came in the form of a white bull and abducted a black princess because the Phoenicians were a black people. Some scholars believe that before the Indo-European penetration of southern Europe and Asia, Greece was called Europe. Most likely, some Cretans settled in Greece. Herbert Went says that the name Europe is derived from the Shemitic word Erev. He said that the ancient Asiatics considered the word Erev to be something dark, ignorant, and mysterious, and therefore Europe, the dark part of the earth. A social cataclysm earthquake struck the island of Crete and destroyed its capital at Knossos about 2000 BC. These black Philistines migrated from Kaphtor, Crete, to the land of Canaan and settled along the southern coast of Palestine. The land of Palestine gets its name from the Philistines who inhabited that region. Chapter 4, The Original Black Jews. Originally, all Hamites and Shemites, or Semites, were black. Abraham was a black Shemite and a descendant of Shem. The name of Abraham was Abram before he was referred to as Abraham. The three Hebrew patriarchs were Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This Jacob begot 12 sons, who later fathered the 12 tribes of Israel. Abraham was the father not only of the Hebrew Israelite nation, but also of the Arab nation. Now, the mother and grandmother of the Arabian nation were black Hamite Egyptian women, and the fathers of the Arabian nation were Abraham and Ishmael, black Shemites. At a certain time, there were hard feelings between Sarah, Abraham's wife, and Hagar, Sarah's maidservant. So Hagar fled from Abraham's house and dwelt in the wilderness. Josephus, the Jewish historian, wrote that Ishmael married an Egyptian woman. As a result, he begot 12 sons: Nabujak, Kedar, Abial, Mibsam, Mishma, Duma, Masa, Hadar, Tema, Jetur, Nafish, and Kedama. These 12 sons became 12 tribes and inhabited the region from the Euphrates to the Red Sea in the Arabian Peninsula. This country is known today as Arabia. To those who do not believe that the ancient Arabians were black, I would like to make one point crystal clear. If your mother and grandmother were black, I am positive that you would have many colored feathers. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 tribes of Israel were all black people. This I shall prove to you by a gradual method. After Joseph was sold down into Egypt as a slave, we find in the 42nd chapter of Genesis, he has become the viceroy of Egypt. Joseph's ten brothers came into Egypt. Egypt is in Africa, to buy corn because a famine was in the land. All newcomers who came into Egypt had to buy corn from Joseph. But when Joseph's 10 brothers came to Africa, they did not recognize him. They did not recognize him because Joseph had grown up and the Egyptians were a black people, like the sons of Jacob. Jacob's 10 sons considered Joseph to be another black Egyptian. We know this to be true because the 10 brothers returned and reported to their father, "The man who is the Lord of the land spoke roughly to us. Furthermore, if Joseph had been white, he would have aroused the curiosity of his brothers very rapidly. We really do not need any more proof that the Israelites were black, but for the sake of argument, I will offer it." In many places in the Bible, we find the sons of Jacob and the later Israelites taking black Canaanite women for wives. If the ancient Israelites were not originally black, they would be after the intermingling with black Canaanite men and women. When the king, Pharaoh of Egypt, promulgated an edict to cast all the Hebrew male babies into the Nile River, Miriam and her mother hid the baby Moses in a basket alongside the river. Meanwhile, Pharaoh's daughter came down to the Nile to wash herself, and she saw the basket and the baby Moses. Pharaoh's daughter knew that the baby was a Hebrew, and she adopted him. If Moses had been a white baby, it would have been difficult to conceal him from her father's anger. In the period of Moses, the black Egyptians enslaved the black Jews. Another point to prove that the Jews were black is the leprosy laws, with it written in the 13th chapter of Leviticus and explained in the second chapter of this book. The strangest and most amazing phenomenon concerning biblical leprosy was that the skin turned white. These laws of leprosy were given to the nation of Israel, and they could not apply to a white nation. Herbert Wendt wrote in his book, "It Began in Babel." All indications point to the fact that Asia was the cradle of the black race. It is written in the book of Daniel, chapter 7, verse 9, "I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire." The meaning of this verse is as follows: "I beheld till the thrones were cast down, the thrones were placed down and erected, and the Ancient of Days did sit. The God of the universe is the Ancient of Days who sat on the throne, and the hair of his head like pure wool." Daniel saw an anthropomorphic form of God judging the nations in the appearance of a venerable man with woolly hair like a black man. Daniel the prophet and the people in his environment, the Babylonians, must have had woolly hair for him to dream of God having woolly hair. Many Israelites in biblical times intermarried with Canaanite Hamitic tribes, and if the Jews were not black, the Israelites became much darker of a surety after the intermingling. Summary: there is more than enough evidence to prove that all the original Israelites were black, including the surrounding nations in the Middle East. We must consider the evidence that the Dravidians were the original black people of India, that the Cushites, Ethiopians inhabited the southern Mesopotamian valley, that Abraham and Ishmael married African women, Egyptians, that the Canaanites belonged to the African family of nations, that ancient Israel intermarried with these black Canaanite tribes. At the time that Joseph was viceroy of Egypt, his brothers could not distinguish him from the black Egyptians because Joseph was black. After Pharaoh promulgated the cruel decree to extirpate the Hebrew males, only a black Moses would have been able to be concealed effectively for any length of time among the black Egyptians. That Daniel had a dream of an anthropomorphous God with woolly hair. That biblical leprosy laws of the time could apply only to a very dark people with black hair. The black Jews of India, Abyssinia, Ethiopia, and West Africa consider themselves the original Jews because of the purity of their Israelite blood. This has been stated by the Allen H. Godby. Now we know that Asia was the birthplace of the black race. How did these people in Asia become lighter in complexion? There are five answers to this question. The Indo-European invasion of Germanic invasion of Asia. 2. The Greek invasion of the Middle East. 3. The Roman invasion of the Middle East and North Africa. 4. The Jewish slave trade. And fifth, the Arab slave trade. The Indo-European invaders penetrated the Middle East and mixed with black Asiatics as far away as India during the second millennium BC. The European Scythians passed through southern Russia and Central Asia as far as the borders of China. During the Greek and Roman invasions, their soldiers settled down in the Middle East and North Africa to disseminate Greek and Roman culture. Moreover, they married colored women. The Jews sold white slaves to the Arabs throughout Africa and Asia. When the black Moors from North Africa conquered Portugal and Spain, they transported thousands of white slaves of Germanic descent to Africa. All of these white people who came or were brought to Africa and Asia were absorbed into the native population. Black Arabs, Black Jews, and Ethiopians. Arabia, the land of the offspring of Ishmael, the son of Abraham, is bordered on the east by the Indian Ocean, on the northeast by the Persian Gulf, on the north by the Arabian Desert, and on the west by the Red Sea. The most fertile region of this peninsula is the south and southwest. At one point, it almost reaches Ethiopia, which is in Africa. There were many Kushite tribes, Ethiopians, living in the northern, western, and southern sections of Arabia. The Arabians have had a long history of intercourse with the Ethiopians in the peninsula of Arabia and with the Ethiopians across the Red Sea in the continent of Africa. James Bruce, author of Travels to Discover the Source of the Nile, says that the people in Yemen, Arabia, particularly those of the coast opposite Saba, Sheba, were reputed Abyssinians, Ethiopians, from the earliest periods till after the Muslim conquest. Many of the Arabs are not black today because of the crossing with white slaves in their households and harems. It is a known fact that there were Ethiopians inhabiting Arabia in the north, southwest, and the southeast. How did these Ethiopians establish domicile residence in southwest Arabia? Because Ethiopians lived around the Persian Gulf in northern Arabia, it is highly probable that they migrated towards the southeast and the southwest. It is obvious that the Kushite inhabited vital parts of Arabia before the birth of the progenitors of the Arabs. Ra'ama, the son of Cush, was the father of the Kushite Sheba and Dedan, Genesis chapter 10, verse 7, about 2300 BC. The tribe of Ra'ama became remarkable merchants, Ezekiel chapter 27, verse 22. The descendants of Ra'ama lived in the southeast Arabia, and the descendants of Havilah resided in southwest Arabia, which is Yemen. This Havilah was the son of Cush. Moreover, Cush was the patriarch of all the Ethiopian tribes in Babylon, Arabia, India, and on the Nile River. The Cushites were residents of Arabia soon after the confusion of the tongues at Babylon, 2247 BC. But Ishmael, the father of the Arabs, was not born until 1896 BC. My conclusion is that the Ethiopians were in Arabia before the Arabs. In the year 1012 BC, an Ethiopian queen named Belkis visited King Solomon in Jerusalem. Belkis came from the kingdom of Sheba in southern Arabia. Sheba was part of the Ethiopian Empire. This empire included Upper Egypt, Ethiopia, and parts of Arabia, which included the kingdom of Sheba. The Jewish historian Flavius Josephus calls this queen the Queen of Egypt and Ethiopia. Calling this queen the Queen of Ethiopia is proper when you know the historical background and genealogy of the early inhabitants of Arabia. The Queen of Sheba is known also as the Queen of the South. The Queen of Sheba and Ethiopia was one empire to the south of the land of Israel. We must remember that on the map, Yemen, Arabia, almost touches Ethiopia in Africa. It is obvious that the Queen of Sheba had more than one name, because she is known to the Ethiopians by the name Makeda. Nevertheless, it is not strange that she had more than one name. The Ethiopian story of Makeda, the Queen of Sheba, is transmitted to us from the Abyssinian archives. This important document is known as the Kebra Nagesh, or Honor of the Kings. The Ethiopian account relates the itinerary of the Queen of Ethiopia to meet King Solomon in Jerusalem. She came with a great train, a retinue of officials, servants, and abundant wealth. While she was at Jerusalem, she became infatuated with King Solomon because of the organization of his affairs, his wealth, his wisdom, his understanding, and physical appearance. Moreover, the story relates that King Solomon fathered a child by the Queen of Ethiopia. This child was called David or Menelik first. The queen returned to Sheba or Saba with Menelik first. After Menelik had remained in Ethiopia for some years, his mother sent him to King Solomon to be educated. Menelik was crowned king of Ethiopia in Jerusalem, and at that time he accepted the name David. Many experts in the law of Moses, especially one from each tribe, accompanied him to Ethiopia in order to be judges in his kingdom. From these experts, the present umbaris, or supreme judges, three of whom always administer to the king, are said to be descended. In the company of this retinue came also Azarias, the son of Zadok, the former high priest, and brought with him a Hebrew transcript of the law. The present Falashas, the black Jews of Ethiopia, claim descent from those Jews who returned from Jerusalem with Solomon's son, Menelik. Moreover, the present emperor of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie, claims descent from the King of Solomon and Queen of Sheba and Menelik first. The Queen of Sheba died about 986 BC after reigning 40 years. Menelik the first ascended the throne, and his posterity, the documents of Ethiopia say, have reigned ever since. James Bruce, the English explorer, says, "This is no new doctrine. It has been tenaciously and continuously maintained from the earliest records of the period when all Ethiopia was Jewish. Then, in later years, after they had embraced Christianity, furthermore," says James Bruce, "all the adjacent nations agree with the Ethiopian account, whether adversaries or friends, in regard to the Queen of Sheba. They only differ in the names of the queen." Again, this writer says, "All the inhabitants of the coast of Arabia Felix were known as Ethiopians from the most ancient times until after the Islamic conquest. These people were the subjects of the Queen of Ethiopia. They were pagans, then converted to Judaism during the time of the construction of the first temple, and they were Jews from the time to the year 622 AD, as the tradition says. When they became Muslims by the sword of Muhammad." Before the introduction of the three influential religions in Arabia, Judaism, Christianity, and Mohammedanism, the Arabs worshipped the stars, idols, and the Kaaba stone. I shall write about the history of the Jews in Arabia, then I shall write pertaining to the Christians in Arabia, and last I shall write concerning the Mohammedans who emerged in the 7th century AD. Thousands of Jews migrated to Egypt and Arabia when the Roman general Titus destroyed the city of Jerusalem AD 70. When the Jews revolted AD 130, Emperor Hadrian dispatched General Julius Severus to Palestine to suppress the revolt. The persecution and restrictions imposed on the Jews were so great that a large number of Jews fled into Arabia. The tradition of the colored Yemenite Jews of Arabia relates that the first Jews came to Arabia when the prophet Jeremiah, just before Nebuchadnezzar, destroyed the first temple. In considering the Jews of Arabia, we cannot forget that Jews that accompanied the Queen of Sheba and her son Menelik first. It is obvious from many indications that the Queen of Sheba or her son Menelik transferred their capital from Sheba to Ethiopia in Africa, or that they had a second capital at Aksum, Ethiopia, on the order of a summer residence. It is not exactly known when the capital was transferred or when Aksum came into prominence as a Jewish state, but it probably occurred between the years 990 and 575 BC. At this last date, the Persians conquered Arabia, resulting in the immigration of more Sabians and Habashites, Abyssinians into Ethiopia. Many of the leaders and inhabitants of this Aksumite state became Jewish and seized political domination of ancient Ethiopia, called Aksum. The Aksumite Empire was ruled by Himyaritic immigrants from Arabia, 1st and 2nd centuries AD. According to tradition, the religious centers contained the Ark of the Covenant brought from Jerusalem by the offspring of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. Basil Davidson said that the Great Period of Ethiopia began soon after AD 50 when Aksum became the capital of a new line of kings. It is obvious that these kings were Jews. The success of trade monopoly in ancient times on both sides of the Red Sea between Arabia and Africa meant political and military control of key harbors. This is the reason Ethiopia and southern Arabia were included in one empire. There was much commercial rivalry between Saba, Sheba, Himyar, Habish, and Aksum that resulted in many wars. All of the kings and many of the inhabitants of these cities were Jewish at one time or another. Professor Godbey says that it is an outstanding point of the tradition going back to Solomon's time for both Abyssinia and Yemen that ancient Hebrew kings on both sides of the Red Sea had the title Bar Negash, or Sea Kings. The later Himyarite kings, after 250 BC, controlled both sides of the Red Sea. When the prosperous Himyarite king changed their religion, they attached the pretext of religious extremism to the reasons for waging war against their commercial rivals. The kingdoms of Rayadan and Himyar were united against Habish, Sheba, and Hadramaut about 500 BC. The rivalries between these alliances brought the Roman fleet into military movement in the Arabian Gulf about 1 BC to capture the port of Aden. When the Roman power declined, there were Jewish kings in Hadramaut, Sheba, and Yemen continuing the economic rivalries and trade. During the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th centuries, Judaism was politically powerful in Arabia. This power was predicated on trade monopoly. There were many Jewish kings, Abu Kariba, Masruk, Hu Nuwas, etc. The most notable was Dehu Nuwas. He will be taken into greater consideration later. The genesis of Christianity in Ethiopia and Arabia. About AD 329, a group of Tyrians, Phoenicians, were embarked for India. Their ship met disaster off the shore of Ethiopia, and the only survivors were the two sons of the leader. These boys were captured by the Ethiopians and taken to the court of the king. Frumentis, one of the boys, became instructor to Abraha, the prince. Abraha became later king of Ethiopia. Frumentis taught Christianity to crown prince Abraha and others. Frumentis traveled to the Byzantine Empire, Eastern Roman Empire. He had an audience with the temporal head, Constantine the Great, and the ecclesiastical head, Saint Athanasius. The leaders of the empire were so tremendously impressed with the abilities that they aided him. Frumentius was promoted to the status of bishop and returned to Ethiopia. The bishop erected and established a church in Ethiopia with the support of the new king, Abraha. By Abraha's confession of Christianity, he became a Judeo-Christian. He was eager for the spread of his new faith into the land of his ancestors. The Arabian Peninsula gathering a military expedition of Ethiopians, Abraha crossed the Red Sea with his naval forces and army. He defeated the Black Arabs and conquered the pagan city of Mecca after a long siege. After he had introduced Christianity into Arabia, Abraha returned to his capital at Aksum, Ethiopia. By the early part of the 6th century AD, Jewish power in Yemen had reached its zenith. The power was dominant in Yathrib, later called Medina. This was the time of the golden age of the black Jews in Yemen, never to be archived again. These business tycoons maintained international commerce in a multiplicity of commodities with the East and the West, and the Arab converts to Judaism intermarried with the original Jews. Dihunuas was one of these Arabs who converted to Judaism. He was the king of Yemen about 500 AD. The Jewish sages were invited to teach Judaism to the people at large. When Dihunuas heard that the Jews were being persecuted in the Byzantine Empire, he retaliated by killing some Byzantine merchants and 20,000 Christians in Arabia. This unwise act brought about the fall of the Jewish kingdom. Judaism was not destined to be disseminated in that manner, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, said the Lord.